Fred Harris offers a view of technology in the high street from Electric Avenue.
We're gonna rock down to Electric Avenue.
The chances are that this computer knows about you. Why? Because the fact that you exist is useful information. It's information that someone is prepared to pay for.
I mean, if privacy means anything, it means having some control over the personal information about your life. At the moment, increasingly, personal information we provide, whether to a local authority or to a private company, is sold or transferred to other people for use for purposes which we never dreamt or intended.
Top of the Pops charts are based on record sales. Shops have always provided this kind of sales information, but today the information gathered can extend far beyond what's bought and where.
Yes, it's number one, it's Top of the Pops!
Well, in the old days, charts have been running for 20 years, and in the old days they used to use this thing, which was a diary, where a record shop would record his sales every time he sold something, which was rather time-consuming and very expensive, because on a Saturday night they'd send motorbikes out all around the country to collect those, bring them back to London, then spend the whole day just punching in the data.
Yes, please, I'll take that. Thanks. Well, in a very small way, I'm just about to influence next week's record charts. I know that because this shop is one of the 700 that's used by Gallup when they prepare the hit parade each week.
We have a panel of about 700 record shops, which are chosen out of just over 4,000 in the country. And we install computers in each of those shops. Every time they sell a record, they punch in the catalogue number of that sale. Our computer here dials up all those sales, adds them up, and the one that sells the most comes out on top. Computers made it so much easier because you can collect the information very fast and very cheaply overnight. And also the shop is doing the work of recording the sales for you. Today's Tuesday. Tonight we'll be dialing out to our shops for the first time this week, and then every night of the week we'll be dialing. So we're actually producing a chart every day from Wednesday onwards. So I'm looking on here at last week's data, you can track how one particular record started the week at number 34 and then by the end of the week had reached number 19. So you can follow day by day what the progress is. And that's very useful for the record industry to know, because they can anticipate day to day what the shifts are in the business. Also, when we get all the data in, we can break it down by exactly where and when anything sold. So if you're a record company and you're advertising a new album on television, and you might have spent a lot of money on that, you want to know as fast as you can whether your investment was a good one. Television is enormously powerful in advertising terms. You can go out with an advert on a Wednesday night, and the Thursday your sales can go up by a factor of 5 or 10 or whatever. So we can analyze for you exactly how your product did in one TV area on a day-to-day basis. So we produce reports of that sort, which are available to the industry on the first thing on a Monday morning, which tell them exactly what happened on their products in the previous 7 days.
The official Top 40 in stereo FM, Britain's favourite radio one.
Good afternoon, it's exactly 5 o'clock, and this is Bruno Brooks here in London with the brand new Top 40. Our link with Gallup headquarters tells us the news as it comes in minute by minute. The new Top 40 format is the fastest and most accurate of its kind anywhere in the world. The entire British record industry, including the stars, are about to discover where their records are in Radio 1's official UK chart. The new entries, the climbers, and a possible new number one. Europe's most listened to radio show shares its technology with you, and here's the first new entry. In Excess goes straight in at
number 40.
Off to a good start.
There are over 500 new records released each week. The catalogue numbers of these must be entered into the Gallup computer to keep its files up to date. But can Gallup trust the sales information on their computers? Any computerised information is only as good as its original source, and errors may have been introduced when putting the information into the machine. In a busy shop, it's not always easy to enter information accurately.
Everybody makes mistakes. About 3% of what goes in to our computers is wrong. And that's true of any computer system. If you stick somebody in front of a machine and ask them to punch away on the keyboard, they'll get it wrong about 1 in 15.
Doesn't that muck up your figures?
Well, what we've done is develop a computer program that effectively corrects people's mistakes. If you take an example like the Bangles single, which is in the chart at the moment, now, Bang SP3 is the catalogue number there, the picture disc, and we picked up about 300 sales on that last week. But the computer says that it also expects to find two errors of Bang P3, that's where somebody misses out the S. So what it does is it then combs through all the numbers we've got and looks to see whether it's found those errors, and it actually comes up here and says it found two. So it's then satisfied that when somebody keyed in Bang P3, what they really meant was Bang SP3. It does that for every single catalogue number for which we've received at least 15 sales.
The computer anticipates what the mistake is going to be. It doesn't look at the catalogue as keyed in and say, no. Oh, that's a mistake for Bang SP3.
It does it backwards. It takes a number, and then it works out all the permutations of error that you might get from it. And then it predicts, based on what's always happened in the past, how many times those errors will occur. And the extraordinary thing is how consistent human beings and human failings are. That is, things always come out very close to the kind of levels that you predict. And then you're satisfied that what has occurred is close enough to your prediction for you to be 99.9% certain that that's what they really meant. So effectively you're going back to the shop girl who's punching the number in and saying, excuse me, you didn't really mean that, you meant that, and correcting it at source. And that way we clean up more or less every error that's punched in, and certainly all the significant ones that affect the top 200 charts.
Now that big top 10 at 10, it's down 7, Wet 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 and Billy Bragg with a little help from my friends and She's Leaving Home. At 9, it climbs 21 places for UB40 and Breakfast in Bed. At number 8 this week, the highest climber, climbing 27 places, Phil Collins, In the Air Tonight, 88.
The music business, the chart is very important in the music business, so there's always someone who is out to try to influence it. But the effect of it is absolutely minimal now. In the old days, you see, when you're working with the diary, it's very easy to... You never know who's filled it in, where it's gone, what's been written down, when. So if you want to get hold of this, and some of the stories about it used to be... have become legends about the way that it used to be passed from shop to shop and from hand to hand and things of that sort. If you want to falsify the returns on that, it's not too difficult. Now, with a computer, you know precisely what time each sale was recorded. So that means that you can track exactly the pattern of sales for any particular product. So if the manager of a group, or perhaps someone who's got a very small label with a record at number 183 in the charts, who thinks that, you know, it's a little bit like the tips you get from the jockey in the pub, you know, somebody tipped him a nod that the way you get the record up the chart is to go around and buy a few copies. And it's more of a comic diversion more than anything else now. And we had a case a few months ago. One chap tried to do this, and he drove along the south coast one middle of the week. And we were able to follow him all the way from Dorset right through to Gillingham in Kent, where he arrived there sometime in the middle of the afternoon, I think, buying a couple of copies of their record in each particular shop. And we very quickly picked up that there's something dodgy about this. And so we were able to identify the chap and his car and who he was. We called up the record company and said, look, we think somebody's doing something they shouldn't be. And they came back to us very quickly and said, yeah, we think it's the manager, or we know it's the manager. So we said, okay, can you just get on to him and tell him, don't be silly, and stop it. So they came back and said, well, We tried to get hold of him, but he's not in his office at the moment. So we said, well, we know he's not in his office because we know where he is, and we know the next shop he's about to go into, so would you like us to call the shop? And when he gets there, we'll get him to give you a call so you can let him know what's happening.
I like it. Lovely.
And this week's number two is last week's number one, the Time Lords with Doctoring the TARDIS, which means that Britain has a brand new...
Number one.
It's Bross.
Gallup are one of many organisations collecting information from purchasers, but some of these go much further than just compiling popularity charts.
The name and address of just about every UK citizen over the age of 18 is stored somewhere in these data banks, and that's about 45 million of us.
Next are one of the retailing successes of the 1980s. They're investing heavily in computers to help stay ahead.
Can I help you, please?
Yes, I'll take that.
How would you like to pay?
Cash.
The Next group started out of Jay Hepworth in something in the early part of the century. And I would guess at that point of time, Jay Hepworth knew his customers intimately. We've now got 22,000 employees. We're a company approaching £1 billion turnover. The only possible way that, say, George Davis, the managing director, can know what his persons he's selling it to is to have the computer technology to be able to know his customer intimately. Through technology, he can't meet the hundreds of thousands of people who are shopping in his stores in the year and in the millions who are operating in mail order.
Information on sales is collected at the tills and sent through to the branch computer. The data collected allows each individual shop manager to monitor how various lines are selling.
Every night, this vast mainframe computer here in Bradford dials up those 1,200 small branch computers and picks up the day's sales figures from each. Once it's amassed all that raw data, those lists and lists of numbers, it can then begin to process them into useful information.
Every time a sale is made, we know back here that that item has been sold. This allows us to have much lower stocks in the shops because we're able to stock overnight rather than having to stock once a week. That allows us, in fact, more selling space. It's more on carriage, but the selling space is of more importance to us than the carriage cost to the shops.
There are many different companies in the Next group. One of these, Grattan's, was bought up by Next because of their experience in using computers to run a large mail order business. This was precisely the expertise Next were looking for to set up their own catalogue, the Next Directory.
Directory, wishing to place an order.
And your name, please.
And the initials.
Sorry, wishing to place
your
order.
Credit card number, please.
We're taking orders at the moment at 180 a minute and forecasting 8,000 in the next hour.
Good morning, can I just go up? You wishing to place an order? Come on in, Next Directory, Linda speaking. Are you wishing to place an order?
Direct line, could I have your customer number, please?
Good morning, Scott Cade. Are you wanting to...
To help service mail order requests, Grattan's operators can call up details of over 8 million customer accounts. They can check an individual's credit worthiness, whether the goods wanted are in stock, and pass the order electronically to the adjoining warehouse.
Using the machine, I can see now that the forecast for the day is £2.5 million in value. and something of the order of 50,000 orders. It's also keeping me in touch with what actually will be happening in the warehouses this afternoon and overnight.
Daily sales figures help Grattan's buyers to monitor fashion trends and decide what stock to buy for the coming months.
Based on past history, when we actually get our demand in at the beginning of the season, that is, the request from the customer, we can actually extend out 1 week's request to give us a full 26-week estimate.
It predicts a whole half year's demand on 1 week?
Yes, that's right.
That sounds like guesswork to me.
No, in actual fact, it is based on 3-4 years past information that will actually tell us what it is likely to do.
I'm surprised you can predict fashion.
Yes, but we are actually predicting week by week. The trend is not just at the beginning of the season, it extended out. As we go further into the season, we update that trend, and therefore if we have a sudden high demand on the item, we recognise it immediately and certainly try and cope with it.
Hi, David. You want to know the latest order figures? Yeah, OK, just a moment. I'm able to control the business in a much better way. I'm able to see what is happening almost on a minute-by-minute basis within Grattan. But an example, really, of how it's affected the business. We used to deliver parcels to agents, and it used to take us about 2 weeks to actually get them out of the company. In fact, they're now out of the company that same day, and we deliver within 48 hours to the majority of the people in the country.
Having accumulated credit information about so many people, Grattans realised they could make money selling this information to other businesses and banks. They bought in other lists of names and addresses until they had information on over 48 million people.
And can I have your credit card number, please?
Can I ask you about credit checking? How does that work?
Well, here we have databases with pretty well everybody in the country who's over 18 years of age. We have good and bad credit information about them.
But if I wanted to buy something on HP, you would be able to look me up and see whether I'm a good or bad risk?
That's right.
And who has assessed whether I'm a good or bad risk?
We actually do it using a mathematical scoring technique based upon how long you've lived in your house, whether you're on the electoral roll, whether you've in fact had bad debts with other companies or maybe with ourselves. When one considers we deal with 8 million people on Grattan alone, and we're also a major credit reference bureau for other companies, we are receiving good and bad information from them as well. So there are millions and millions of bits of information which are all collated together, and mathematically we can say what amount of money we're prepared to lend you or not lend you.
I'm on there somewhere.
Yes, you will be.
Do you think that personal information, credit ratings and so on, should be a trading commodity?
Not without our consent, no. If you want to provide your personal information to be stored somewhere so that it can be used as a reference of your creditability, then that's fine, as long as you have the right to go and see it and check that the information they've got is accurate. But if you don't want that to be the case, then it shouldn't be taken and sold without your consent.
But I have got the right to check on it, haven't I?
You have, yes.
The introduction of systems which can build up personal records of customers' purchases is encouraging the development of a new aggressive form of marketing. Lists of personal information are used to produce closely targeted junk mail.
We build up selling patterns continuously, and if I could go back to the mail order operation, we have 6 years' worth of selling trends and the types of merchandise people buy. We know when, for example, somebody gets newly married, they're normally poor because they're paying mortgages and they're right up to the hilt of their expenditure. Gradually then, for a year or two, they gradually become more and more wealthy, and then so we have to push to them various better quality merchandise than we were actually selling to them before. Then they're going to have children, and we can spot that they have had children by buying certain types of dresses and various underwear that's required for people who are having babies. They then switch back to a poor lifestyle. It's very noticeable. 5 or 6 years of that, and they're gradually building again. And one then notices as they come to the children of 15, 16, 17, we keep records of when they're 18 years old, and we are able to push more of very good lifestyle products to the parents and cheap
stuff
to... You're
actually keeping records on individual clients, individual customers.
They're selling of what they bought, and I mean, in Gretna's case, it's 6 years old now, and that we have everything that anybody's bought with us and who's still with us for the last 6 years. Now, we are starting to build that on the shop traffic, where, in fact, they are using credit cards. So we can start... We know what they bought in the shop. We can maybe push that style of merchandise to them in through the next directory and various other selling
companies. Some people might find that a little bit worrying, that you're kind of keeping tabs on them, a little bit of the big brother.
One can say it's a little bit of big brother, but really we are merchants trying to sell our merchandise. Now, it's only in a different way of presentation that you might actually see in a store. Mail order companies and companies that have this sort of information are ones who are basically selling merchandise. They're not looking to use the information other than to sell a dress or sell a pair of shoes or a carpet, curtains. Somebody changes their name and address, then they're ready for all sorts of new items for their house, and there's a lot of money that they're going to spend at that point of time, especially if they've moved from, let me say it, the London area into the Midlands or to the north. They normally have a big sum of money which they want to spend, and because of the information that we have, we're in as good a position as any to be able to spot that and be able to push our wares, if you like, before maybe the high street can push its.
Let's talk about these personal profiles that are being built up. Now, in certain shops, that information goes onto a computer which builds up a kind of lifestyle picture of you. I'm sure people would be surprised that happens, but should they be concerned?
Yes, I think they should be concerned. It's two reasons, really. It's one, that we don't like other people and the government to know our private details, but it's also the potential that it gives outside organisations and the state potentially to control our lives and influence our lives because of the personal information they have about us. So it's a wider question. It's not just a sort of, you know, we don't like it. It actually has wider implications.
Yes, but at one level it's only about what kinds of things you buy. You buy a pink shirt, so you know, oh, here's a man interested in pink shirts, we'll send him a catalogue with pink shirts in.
But that's intrusive. We might not want to be sent a catalogue of pink shirts.
The information that's stored and the people that are storing it, can they do pretty well what they like with it?
They have to register what they're doing with it under the Data Protection Act, but in fact that's all they have to do, and if they've registered it, then they can go ahead and do it. So it's unfortunately a very weak act, and it doesn't actually provide the sort of safeguards you might expect it to.
What do they do with this information?
Well, of course, different organisations do different things with it. One of the things that worries us most is that some organisations sell it. And of course, the fact that it can now be bought on computer tape makes it much more likely that it will be bought, and then it's used to build up these huge national data banks, which end up in us getting junk mail.
I can see that your motives are perfectly clean, but somebody might want to use that information for totally nefarious purposes, perhaps a private detective or something. Who has access to that information?
Well, I mean, there are extremely tight controls on how that information can be used. I mean, I can get into this machine and virtually go anywhere in it, but there are very strict regulations on how people can do that. Normally, any one individual only has one type of access for the particular type of work that they want to do. In fact, that information that I'm talking about there is really only available to about four people in marketing.
You can guarantee that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But as other organisations have found, when it comes to data security, you shouldn't be overconfident.